So in the next few lectures, we will be seeing module 5 of internal combustion engines. This entire module is divided into two main parts. The first part is engine testing and performance, and the second part is exhaust analysis. So in the first part, we will be seeing how tests are done on the engine and how its performance parameters are measured. See, whenever you are going to choose an engine for your vehicle, see, there will be many things that you want to know about that engine. Means basically, imagine you are designing a motorcycle. So whenever you are designing a motorcycle, you have to determine what will be the maximum power required from the engine of the motorcycle. See, what happens mostly whenever car manufacturers are manufacturing their cars, not all car manufacturers make their own engines. Engines are designed by some other people. For example, let us take Maruti Suzuki. Maruti Suzuki does not manufacture its own engines. So imagine now they are going to make a car like Swift. So what they are going to do? They are going to do some calculations. They are going to determine, okay, my Swift is going to be so big. This will be the mass of Swift. This will be the number of people who will be sitting in Swift. This will be the maximum weight that they will be carrying in this car. So they determine the maximum weight of the car. They determine what should be the maximum speed of the car. What should be the maximum acceleration of the car. So they do these calculations, and based on these calculations, they determine what should be the maximum power of the engine required. And now based on the maximum power of the engine required, what is the size of the bonnet available? What is the cooling capacity available? And based on all these things, they will go to a engine manufacturer and tell him that I need this specification engine. So based on these specifications, either the engine manufacturer will manufacture a new engine or modify an existing engine to satisfy the current conditions. So Maruti Suzuki takes all its engines from Fiat. Fiat's cars are not so famous in India, but most of the Maruti Suzuki cars have Fiat engines in them. So Maruti Suzuki gives certain specifications to Fiat, and accordingly they give them the engine. So whenever Fiat is giving the engine, they have to satisfy all the criteria which are given to them by Maruti Suzuki, right? That this much power must be produced, this much should be the RPM. So whenever Fiat has to produce such an engine, it also has to test these parameters. Right, it has to make sure that all the specifications given by Maruti are satisfied by its engine. So how do they do that? They do that by using engine performance analysis. Okay, so what all things are included in the engine performance analysis? See, some of the things include like engine dimensions. So how big the engine is, right? It should sit in the bonnet. What is the fuel consumption rate? Means that is the most important thing for large number of Indians. What is the kilometer per liter? But whenever talking technically, we do not say it kilometer per liter. We measure fuel consumption in terms of BSFC, brake specific fuel consumption. We will come to that afterwards. Then they calculate what is the air consumption rate, what is the air fuel ratio that is required for various operating conditions. The most important thing, what is the power developed by the engine? Okay, what is the power developed by the engine? What is the efficiency of the engine? What is the final engine power output? Okay, and in the end, we come to what is the exhaust gases produced by the engine, right? We will come to this. This is the second part of this module. It deals with exhaust gases. Okay, see, the first part, as I said, this is all the engine parameters. And the second part is your exhaust analysis. Nowadays, you must have heard of Bharat 4 and Bharat 6 emission norms, okay, BS4, BS6. So these emission norms dictate what should be the exhaust coming out of the vehicle. See, what happens if your car is producing too much of exhaust? Consider the large number of cars that are on our roads today. If each and every car is producing so much of exhaust, we won't even be able to breathe, right, because of all those emissions. So governments do some kind of regulations, create some kind of regulations which control how much emissions can be produced, right? That is what they do. So those emissions must also be measured before that engine can be satisfied. So that is why even exhaust emissions are taken into account when selecting an engine. So we will be seeing all these things in detail now. Okay. So that is why it is necessary to measure the engine parameters so that we know that this engine satisfies these conditions. So how is engine performance testing done? See, there are two ways to check the performance of a vehicle, output of a vehicle, what are the actual, how the vehicle is going to work on the road. See, the first is using an engine dynamometer. So this thing is an engine dynamometer. This blue one is an engine dynamometer and this yellow thing is your engine. Okay. So what is basically happening? We connect this engine to this dynamometer and test the engine output. All the parameters that I had said, what will be the engine RPM, what will be the engine power output, what will be the emissions from the engine, all these things are tested using this engine dynamometer. Engine dynamometer is easier to use. Why is it easier to use? Because you do not have to implement the engine on the vehicle itself, right? You just have to connect this engine to your dynamometer and you can start testing. Connect a few other things like your exhaust analysis, RPM sensor and all those things, and you can start the analysis. The other way to check out the performance is using a chassis dynamometer. Now, using a chassis dynamometer is quite difficult. You can see over here, this is your chassis dynamometer. In case of chassis dynamometer, what you have to do, you have to put the engine in the vehicle and you have to test the entire vehicle itself. Okay. See, you can see these rubber things, okay, they are holding the vehicle back, okay, so that the vehicle doesn't go forward. You can see a large number of things coming out of here. Over here, you will also have your exhaust gas analysis, okay. So this is on a chassis dynamometer. So this wheel will be rotating and this thing is like your conveyor belt, okay, it will also be rotating. It is like that exercise thing on which you continuously walk and the lower thing keeps on rotating, like your treadmill. Okay, this is your chassis dynamometer. Now, chassis dynamometer gives you a more accurate real life view of what is going to happen to your vehicle when it is on road, right? But whenever you are actually designing the engine, you do not have time to install the engine on the vehicle, test it, take down the readings, then again remove it from the engine, again make changes, again install it on the vehicle, test it again. It takes too much of time. So initially all the testing is done on engine dynamometer. Once you do testing on engine dynamometer, you get a basic idea. You make the necessary changes and after that you go to chassis dynamometer. Okay, chassis dynamometer testing is like the final stage testing. So this is how the engine performance is actually tested in industries. So whenever you are using the chassis dynamometer, there are certain rules. How exactly will you test the vehicle, right? At what speed are you going to drive the vehicle? Should it be very fast? Should it be very slow? Should you drive it at what speed should it be? And for how long should that speed be kept? Well, that also, all those rules have also been given by the government. It is known as an Indian driving cycle. So you can look over here in the Indian driving cycle, what is it? From 0 to approximately 18 seconds, their vehicle is stationary. Okay, the engine is on and the vehicle is stationary. Then you accelerate the vehicle to a speed of approximately 20 to 23 kilometers per hour. Then you decelerate it, accelerate it, decelerate it, and it goes on. So in this way, it is a 110 second cycle. In this, they are specifying the speed at which the vehicle should be driven. Okay. In this way, the vehicle should be driven on the chassis. This is done 6 times. And this is how they check the emissions. If you have seen any advertisements of vehicles, they give you the KMPL rating as per ARAI. So how do they calculate that KMPL rating? They put the car on the chassis dynamometer, run the car at Indian driving cycle and check the mileage. All the testing that is done of the vehicle, final testing that is done of the vehicle, it is always done on the chassis dynamometer using the Indian driving cycle. Okay, so this is not extremely important to you. all that I have said till now, but this is like a good general information for you whenever you go for interviews and things. This is not a part of your syllabus as such, but still it is always good to know that how an engine and how a vehicle is actually tested. So there are two ways. It can either be an engine dynamometer or it can be a chassis dynamometer. In your syllabus, you have several sums on engine dynamometer. We'll be looking at this in this module itself. Okay. So what is basically an engine dynamometer? See, whenever you have an engine, see, imagine that this dynamometer is not present. You have just your engine. You have your engine. You connect it to all the things and you put in the petrol or diesel and whatever it is, and you start running the engine. So the engine will produce power. See, over here, you will have the engine crankshaft. Over here, you will have the engine crankshaft. So what is going to happen? The crankshaft is going to rotate continuously. Imagine for some time that there is no dynamometer. So the crankshaft will keep on rotating. Array, but there is no opposition to that crankshaft, right? The crankshaft is rotating freely. So there is nothing here that is absorbing the power of the crankshaft, right? See, whenever you want to test the power of a motor, see, what do? Whenever we want to test whether a motor is strong or weak, what do? We turn on the motor and try to hold the shaft. If we are able to hold the shaft to a stop, that means that the power of the motor is not very high. But even after holding it, if the motor shaft keeps on rotating, it means that the power of the motor is more. Means what are we doing when we hold the motor shaft? We are applying a load on the motor, right? Whenever we try to hold the motor, we are applying a load on the motor. Another example, see, if your fan is rotating in your house, if you have a fan and it is rotating, initially it is rotating freely, hence it has high velocity. But if you put your hand onto the fan and try to stop it, see, if it is at a slow speed, even with less amount of force, you will be able to stop the fan, right? Why? Because currently the power developed by the fan is less. But if the fan is rotating at very high speed, you won't be able to stop it with your hand, right? Why? Because the power developed by the fan at that point is more. So that is basically the function of dynamometer. What is the function of dynamometer? Dynamometer produces an opposing force on the engine. Okay, it is used to load the engine. It is used to load the engine. This is the official term. Okay, so what is the function of dynamometer? The function of dynamometer is to load the engine. And only after loading the engine can we actually check out what is the performance of the engine. Okay, so that is what a dynamometer does. It measures the output of the engine. For example, it means to understand it even better. See, what are we doing? Ki, how is the engine output going to change with load? For example, let us say that you are going to test your bike engine. Okay, you are a bike manufacturer and you have to check how the bike's output is going to change with changing load. How is the load going to change? Initially, there will be only one person. Imagine you are driving the motorbike alone. So you are only sitting on the bike. Now you are taking a friend with you. So there are two people on the bike. The load immediately doubles. Initially, let us say you are only 70 kg. So the load on the bike is 70 kg. Now if two people are sitting, the load on the bike is 140 kg. Now imagine three people are sitting somehow. So the load becomes, say, approximately 200 kg. So we have all these three different conditions for your bike engine. The three different powers are produced by the bike engine. How are you going to reproduce these conditions during the testing field? Right? You have to test your engine for these three conditions. So how are you going to produce these three conditions for your engine? Then we use a dynamometer. Okay? How a dynamometer works, what are the different types of dynamometers, we will see it later on. There is an entire different lecture for how a dynamometer works. But basically what a dynamometer does is a dynamometer loads the engine and a dynamometer is used to measure the torque output of the engine. So a dynamometer performs two functions. It is used to load the engine and it is used to measure the torque output of the engine. Right. So whenever we are testing the engine, I hope you have understood it till now. So we are going to test the engine using that dynamometer. And whenever we are testing the engine, there are several things that we have to check, the values of which we have to calculate. So what are the things that we measure? The things that we measure include the engine speed, engine torque, engine load, compression ratio, fuel consumption rate, air consumption rate, air fuel ratio, stoichiometric ratio. Okay, so these are all the things that we measure. Okay, you can just see all these things. These are 16 things. There are even more. These are just the things that are included in your syllabus. You have sums on these things. Okay, it is possible that they give you some of these terms and ask you to find the others in your sums. Okay, if you are actually working in an industry, you are actually testing vehicles or testing engines, there are a large number of parameters that you are going to measure. These are only some of those parameters. Okay, so we will look at each and every term. We have to look at the definition. I don't want you to learn the definition by heart, but you should know basically what each and everything is, right? Okay, so based on these definitions, there are also some efficiencies. Okay, so efficiency in short is output upon input, but in case of engine, there are several different efficiencies. We'll be looking at all these things. And even during engine testing, see what is happening. Just let us take a look once. See what is happening. This engine is producing power. How is this engine producing power? This engine is producing power by burning fuel, right? There is some fuel which is poured into the engine. That fuel is burnt and it is producing power, right? And what is the that is the input power, right? The fuel that we put into the engine, that is the input power. What is the output power that we are getting? The output power that we are getting is the rotation of this crankshaft, the mechanical energy produced by the crankshaft. So there are several efficiencies, ki how efficiently combustion takes place inside the engine. How efficiently is that power transmitted from the piston to the crankshaft? How efficient is the engine overall? All these efficiencies have to be measured. Okay, and these efficiencies are the efficiencies which are mentioned over here. And similarly, the amount of heat energy released by the engine, the amount of heat energy produced inside the engine is used to do several different things. So where all that heat goes, all that has also be taken into account, because we have to ensure that maximum amount of heat is used to produce work, that heat is not lost to the coolant, heat is not lost to the exhaust gases. And why is it necessary to measure these quantities? If we know what is the heat absorbed by the coolant, then we can adjust the coolant flow rate. If we do not know how much heat is absorbed by the coolant, that we won't know what should be the coolant flow rate, right? If we do not know what is the amount of heat energy lost to exhaust gases, we won't be able to put our catalytic converter, because catalytic converter needs to run hot. Okay, that is why all these things have to be measured. What is the heat absorbed by the various engine parts? We have to ensure that the heat absorbed by the engine parts is less. Otherwise, the engine parts might melt. That is why all these things have to be calculated. Okay, so this is what this module is going to be about. Initially, what are we going to do? We are going to look at all the initial important terms. Again, I say this, just understand these terms, what these terms exactly mean. There is no need to learn all these terms by heart, right? But you must understand what each and every term means. So the first term is engine speed. What is engine speed? Engine speed is basically, in simple words, engine speed is the RPM of the crankshaft. What is engine speed? Engine speed is the RPM of the crankshaft. So how many times the crankshaft is rotating in 1 minute? That is your engine RPM. So the final engine output is received where? The final engine output is received from this crankshaft, right? So how fast this crankshaft rotates, that is your engine RPM. And that is known as engine speed. Engine speed is measured generally in terms of RPM, and that RPM can be converted into angular velocity using 2 pi n upon 60. And the tool used to measure the engine RPM is your tachometer. The next thing is your engine torque. See, what is torque? You should know the definition of torque. Torque is the force produced on or acting on a body at a distance. Okay, it is the rotational force produced or acting on a body. It is the force acting at a particular distance, right? So what is happening? You see, for example, the example that I gave you before, if you have two motors, there is one motor which when you both motors are running, the first motor, when you hold with your fingers, you are able to stop the shaft from rotating. And the second motor is such that even after you hold the shaft with all your fingers, with all your force, the motor keeps on rotating. Means what? The first motor has less torque, that you can stop the rotation easily. And the second motor has more torque. You are not able to stop the rotation of the motor easily. That is basically what torque is. Torque is with how much force the motor is rotating. Or in our case, with how much force the crankshaft is rotating. Okay, so that is your torque. Ideally, we want the engine torque to be high as possible. Especially in case of, see, trucks. In case of trucks or heavy duty vehicles, the torque should be very high. In case of lighter vehicles, for example, our passenger cars, the torque should be low. And in case of our motorbikes, the torque should be even low. So torque is the rotational force produced by the engine. What is engine load? Engine load is the opposing torque acting on the engine. Means what? You have your car, you are sitting in your car. What is the force against which the engine has to work? That is your engine load. And in our real life, this engine load is provided by what? This engine load is provided by the people sitting in the car, the load inside the car, whatever things you have put in the truck, all that. But in case of our testing, that load is provided by the dynamometer. Okay, so this is how these are the three definitions. Okay, engine speed kya hai, kitne fast engine gol gol ghum raha hai. इंजन टॉर्क क्या है? इंजन टॉर्क मतलब कितना फोर्स वो इंजन प्रोड्यूस कर रहा है. और इंजन लोड मतलब क्या है? इंजन लोड मतलब वो इंजन के ऊपर कितना लोड हम लोग डाल रहे हैं कि जिसके अगेंस्ट वो इंजन काम कर रहा है. ठीक है, सो दीज आर द बेसिक डेफिनेशंस. द नेक्स्ट डेफिनेशन इज कंप्रेशन रेशियो. सो यू शुड नो कंप्रेशन रेशियो बाय नाउ. इट इज द वेरी सिंपल डेफिनेशन. कंप्रेशन रेशियो इज रेशियो ऑफ वॉल्यूम ऑफ कंबशन चेंबर when piston is at BDC to volume of combustion chamber when piston is at TDC. Okay, this is one definition that you should know by heart. Okay, so this is what? This is your TDC, this is your BDC, this volume is your clearance volume, this volume is your swept volume. And what is compression ratio? Compression ratio is VS plus VC divided by VC. Okay, so that is how it is. What is fuel consumption rate? Fuel consumption rate, it is simple. Ki how fast is the fuel being consumed? Okay, how fast is the engine consuming the fuel? What is the common method of, what is the common term used for measuring it? Grams per second or kg per hour? Ki how much amount of fuel is consumed in 1 second? How many grams of fuel is consumed in 1 second? Or how many kg of fuel is consumed in 1 hour? 1 घंटे में कितना फ्यूल लगता है या फिर 1 सेकेंड में कितना फ्यूल लगता है. सो दैट इज योर फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट. वॉट इज एयर कंजम्पशन रेट? सिमिलर टू फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट, इन फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट वी आर मेजरिंग हाउ मच अमाउंट ऑफ फ्यूल इज कंज्यूम्ड इन अ स्पेसिफिक अमाउंट ऑफ टाइम. सिमिलरली एयर कंजम्पशन रेट इज हाउ मच अमाउंट ऑफ एयर इज कंज्यूम्ड बाय द इंजिन इन स्पेसिफिक अमाउंट ऑफ टाइम. इट इज ऑल्सो मेजर्ड इन टर्म्स ऑफ आइदर ग्राम पर सेकेंड और के जी पर आर. What is air fuel ratio? See, even this term has been explained to you before. Air fuel ratio is simply how much amount of air, what is the mass flow rate of air divided by mass flow rate of fuel. Basically, डेफिनेशन नंबर 7 इज डेफिनेशन नंबर 6 डिवाइडेड बाय डेफिनेशन नंबर 5. व्हाट इज द मास फ्लो रेट ऑफ एयर डिवाइडेड बाय मास फ्लो रेट ऑफ फ्यूल. ओके, सो टू अंडरस्टैंड एयर फ्यूल रेशियो, सी फॉर एग्जाम्पल इफ योर इंजिन इज कंज्यूमिंग फ्यूल एट से 1 kg पर आर. ओके सॉरी, इमेजिन दैट द फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट इज 1 kg पर आर. दैट इज योर फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट. दैट इज इन 1 hour द इंजिन टेक्स इन 1 kg फ्यूल एंड योर एयर कंजम्पशन रेट इज 22 kg पर आर. मीन्स वॉट, इन 1 hour इट रिक्वायर्स 22 kg ऑफ एयर. योर इंजिन रिक्वायर्स इन 1 hour 22 kg ऑफ एयर एंड 1 kg ऑफ फ्यूल. देन योर एयर फ्यूल रेशियो विल बी 22/1. ओके, सो दैट इज योर एयर फ्यूल रेशियो, राइट. द नेक्स्ट टर्म इज स्टोइकोमेट्रिक एयर फ्यूल रेशियो. सी ईच एंड एवरी फ्यूल रिक्वायर सम अमाउंट ऑफ एयर टू बर्न. ईच एंड एवरी फ्यूल इज वॉट? फ्यूल इज हाइड्रोकार्बन, CXHY, राइट. वेन CXHY बर्न्स, वॉट इज इट गोइंग टू प्रोड्यूस? इट इज गोइंग टू प्रोड्यूस CO2 एंड H2O, राइट. इट इज गोइंग टू प्रोड्यूस कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड एंड वॉटर. बट टू फॉर एनी गिवन फ्यूल अ सर्टन अमाउंट ऑफ एयर इज रिक्वायर्ड टू कंप्लीटली बर्न दैट फ्यूल, राइट. दैट रेशियो इज नोन एज स्टोइकोमेट्रिक एयर फ्यूल रेशियो. फॉर एग्जाम्पल से इफ यू हैव 1 kg ऑफ डीजल, टू बर्न 1 kg ऑफ डीजल कंप्लीटली हाउ मच अमाउंट ऑफ एयर इज गोइंग टू बी रिक्वायर्ड? 14.4 kg ऑफ एयर इज रिक्वायर्ड टू बर्न 1 kg ऑफ डीजल. सिमिलरली टू बर्न 1 kg ऑफ पेट्रोल अप्रॉक्सिमेटली 14.7 kg ऑफ एयर इज रिक्वायर्ड. सो दिस इज द स्टोइकोमेट्रिक एयर फ्यूल रेशियो. दिस इज द आइडियल अमाउंट ऑफ एयर रिक्वायर्ड टू बर्न द फ्यूल. बट इन एन इंजिन यू डू नॉट गेट दिस सेम रेशियो कॉन्स्टेंटली. ओके, sometimes the amount of air is more, sometimes the amount of fuel is more, right. If the amount of air is more and the amount of fuel is less, then that mixture is known as lean mixture. In lean mixture the amount of fuel is less than the ideal, and in case of rich mixture the amount of fuel is more than the ideal quantity. Okay, so there can be 3 fuel ratios. It can be stoichiometric air fuel ratio. In stoichiometric air fuel ratio, the amount of air is just enough to burn all the fuel. In rich mixture, in rich air fuel ratio, what happens? The amount of fuel is more than the quantity of air to burn it. So what happens? Some amount of fuel remains unburnt. What happens if there is a lean mixture? In lean mixture, the fuel quantity is less and the air quantity is more. So all the fuel will get burnt and some amount of air will remain. So that is stoichiometric air fuel ratio, rich air fuel ratio and lean air fuel ratio. Okay, similar to air fuel ratio, we also have fuel air ratio. Okay, it is just the opposite of air fuel ratio. Okay, in air fuel ratio it is what? Mass flow rate of air divided by mass flow rate of fuel. In fuel air ratio it is what? Mass flow rate of fuel divided by mass flow rate of air. So air fuel ratio and fuel air ratio are inverse of each other. Okay, so what is this equivalence ratio? After this term you will see an example. I know this might be a bit confusing, but try to understand. And this last term, then we will see an example on this. What is equivalence ratio? See, equivalence ratio is defined. You just have to remember this definition for equivalence ratio. What is equivalence ratio? Equivalence ratio is the actual fuel air ratio that is being used inside the engine right now. It is possible that inside the engine currently the air fuel ratio is rich, or else the air fuel ratio is lean. So how will you calculate the equivalence ratio? You calculate the actual fuel air ratio which is being used inside the engine and you divide it by the stoichiometric fuel air ratio. So if you have a petrol engine, what will be the stoichiometric fuel air ratio? It will be 1 divided by 14.7, Why? The stoichiometric air fuel ratio is 14.7. If stoichiometric air fuel ratio for petrol is 14.7, the stoichiometric fuel air ratio will be 1 divided by 14.7. Okay, I will again repeat. See, stoichiometric air fuel ratio. Okay, stoichiometric air fuel ratio for petrol is how much? 14.7. Then what will be the stoichiometric fuel air ratio? If air fuel ratio is 14.7, then air fuel ratio is 14 by 7, then fuel air ratio will be what? Inverse of 14.7. What is inverse of 14.7? 1 divided by 14.7. Okay. So always remember, air fuel ratio is greater than 1. Okay. Air fuel ratio, see, mass of air will always be more than mass of fuel. कितना भी फ्यूल जलाने के लिए उससे ज्यादा अमाउंट ऑफ एयर लगता है, ठीक है? वॉट एवर अमाउंट ऑफ फ्यूल यू हैव टू बर्न, यू नीड मोर मास ऑफ एयर टू बर्न दैट अमाउंट ऑफ फ्यूल. सो एयर फ्यूल रेशियो इज ऑलवेज ग्रेटर देन 1, बट फ्यूल एयर रेशियो इज ऑलवेज लेस देन 1. ओके, द अमाउंट ऑफ एयर रिक्वायर्ड टू बर्न द फ्यूल इज ऑलवेज ग्रेटर. वॉट इज इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो? इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो इज एक्चुअल फ्यूल एयर रेशियो डिवाइडेड बाय स्टोइशोमेट्रिक फ्यूल एयर रेशियो. सो इफ योर मिक्सचर इज रिच, वॉट डज इट मीन? इफ मिक्सचर इज रिच, देर इज मोर अमाउंट ऑफ फ्यूल देन इज रिक्वायर्ड. इन दिस केस इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो इज ग्रेटर देन 1. इफ यू कांट रिमेंबर एवरीथिंग, जस्ट ट्राई टू रिमेंबर दिस टू थिंग्स. ओके, इफ मिक्सचर इज रिच, इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो इज ग्रेटर देन 1, एंड इफ मिक्सचर इज लीन, इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो इज लेस देन 1. ओके, सो दिस इज इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो. नाउ होपफुली टू अंडरस्टैंड ऑल दीज टर्म्स, सी वी विल सी एन एग्जाम्पल. ओके, सो दिस इज अ सिंपल एग्जाम्पल. वॉट हैव दे टोल्ड अस? दैट इन अ टेस्ट ऑन एन इंजिन इट वॉज फाउंड दैट द स्टॉइशोमेट्रिक एयर फ्यूल रेशियो इज वॉट? 14.7. इट इज एन एसआई इंजिन, पेट्रोल इंजिन. सो स्टॉइशोमेट्रिक एयर फ्यूल रेशियो इज वॉट? 14.7. द फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट इज 10 kg पर आर. सो दे हैव गिवन अस वॉट? फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट. मास फ्लो रेट ऑफ फ्यूल इज वॉट? 10 kg पर आर, राइट? दिस इज वॉट दे हैव गिवन अस. एंड एयर कंजम्पशन रेट इज वॉट? 3 kg पर मिनिट. नाउ दे हैव गिवन एयर कंजम्पशन रेट इन मिनिट, केजी पर मिनिट, एंड फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट इन केजी पर आर. नाउ वी कैनॉट कंपेयर दीज टू थिंग्स डायरेक्टली. वाई? बिकॉज द यूनिट्स आर डिफरेंट. सो वॉट विल वी हैव टू डू? वी हैव टू कन्वर्ट इट इन टू द सेम यूनिट. सो आइदर यू कैन कन्वर्ट दिस केजी पर आर टू केजी पर मिनिट, और यू कैन कन्वर्ट दिस केजी पर मिनिट इन टू केजी पर आर. वॉट एवर यू डू, इट इज योर चॉइस. ओके, इन माई केस वॉट आई डिड, आई कन्वर्टेड फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट फ्रॉम केजी पर आर इन टू केजी पर मिनिट. सो इट इज 10 kg पर आर. दे हैव गिवन अस 10 kg पर आर. आई कन्वर्टेड दिस 10 kg पर आर इन टू केजी पर मिनिट. इन 1 आवर देर आर 60 मिनिट्स. सो आई डिवाइडेड दिस बाय 60. सो वॉट डिड आई गेट? आई गॉट दैट 10 kg पर आर इज इक्वल टू 0.166 kg पर मिनिट. दैट इज वॉट? दैट इज माई फ्यूल कंजम्पशन रेट. सिमिलरली वॉट इज माई एयर कंजम्पशन रेट? 3 kg पर मिनिट. दे हैव गिवन इट टू मी डायरेक्टली. वॉट आर दे आस्किंग मी? दे आर आस्किंग मी एयर फ्यूल रेशियो, फ्यूल एयर रेशियो. दे आर आस्किंग मी स्टॉइशोमेट्रिक फ्यूल एयर रेशियो. सी दे हैव गिवन मी स्टॉइशोमेट्रिक एयर फ्यूल रेशियो, एंड दे आर आस्किंग वॉट इज स्टॉइशोमेट्रिक फ्यूल एयर रेशियो. दे आर आस्किंग इक्विवेलेंस रेशियो, and they are asking if it is lean or rich. Okay, all these things are dependent on only these two things: fuel consumption rate and air consumption rate, right? So let us look how this will be. So what have they asked us? They have asked us to find air fuel ratio. Air fuel ratio is what? Mass flow rate of air divided by mass flow rate of fuel. We know mass flow rate of air is what? 3 kg per minute. Mass flow rate of fuel is what? 0.166 kg per minute. See, I have converted everything into kg per minute. You can convert everything into kg per hour. That will also give you the same value. Okay. So I get air fuel ratio as what? 18. What is fuel air ratio? Fuel air ratio is mass flow rate of fuel divided by mass flow rate of air. So 0.1666 divided by 3, which is equal to 0.055. Or else what you can do? Fuel air ratio is what? 1 divided by air fuel ratio. Fuel air ratio is inverse of air fuel ratio. So I can find fuel air ratio as what? 1 divided by 18. This will also give this same value. Okay. What are they asking us? Stoichiometric fuel air ratio. So stoichiometric fuel air ratio is what? Stoichiometric fuel air ratio is the inverse of stoichiometric air fuel ratio. So that is what exactly we have done. 1 divided by stoichiometric air fuel ratio. So 1 divided by 14.7 is equal to what? 0.068. Then they are asking us for equivalence ratio. See, remember this definition for equivalence ratio. What is equivalence ratio? Equivalence ratio is defined as, equivalence ratio is defined as actual fuel air ratio divided by stoichiometric fuel air ratio. What is the actual fuel air ratio? 0.055. What is the stoichiometric fuel air ratio? 0.068. So doing this, we get 0.8. And we know that if air fuel, if equivalence ratio is less than 1, it means that the mixture is lean. And if the equivalence ratio is more than 1, it means that the mixture is rich. So see, if equivalence ratio is greater than 1, it means rich. If it is less than 1, it means lean. In our case, we got equivalence ratio as 0.8. So the mixture is lean. Okay. Hopefully you have understood this sum. With this, I will end this lecture and continue the definitions in the next lecture. Okay. Thank you.